Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Kate Forbes, Deputy First Minister, on European structural and investment funds. The Deputy First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on the Deputy First Minister to make her statement. Up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I made a statement in this chamber on Thursday, the 13th of June, on the Scottish Government's current position with regard to European structural and investment funds. That statement addressed the inaccurate reports in the media, and I made clear that I would make a further statement once both the programmes, the European Social Fund and the European Regional Development Fund, had formally closed. I didn't quite expect the next statement to be quite so soon. I was clear at that point that it is unlikely to be before the second half of 2025. And so, as I said less than a fortnight ago, I would confirm the final outturn figures and outcomes achieved at that point. Until then, estimates of the use of the funding allocations, the final eligible expenditure and the reimbursements back from the European Commission are all speculative. Opposition parties have requested another statement less than a fortnight after my first statement. In the intervening time, nothing has changed, there's no new information, and further reports in the press haven't changed the original points that I made. However, I'm never one to shy away from stating the facts once again, and so, Presiding Officer, I thank you for the opportunity to repeat and to confirm all the points that I made a fortnight ago. As I explained in my statement less than a fortnight ago, the system for administering and paying out European structural funds is retrospective. Allocations of potential funding are notified to member states at the start of each seven-year programme. Projects are then set up by partner organisations and they incur costs. Those costs are incurred initially and entirely by the organisations themselves. So, for example, in the third sector, that might be a charity. In the public sector, that might be local government or Nature Scot. Those costs are then claimed back from the Scottish Government at our risk. Once we've paid the costs incurred by our partners, we then focus on submitting reimbursement claims to the European Commission. Only after all the evidence has been checked and verified are we then reimbursed by the European Commission. Furthermore, the funds cannot be used for core public services. It cannot be used, as some have suggested, to mitigate the impact of austerity on our NHS or on local government or on core infrastructure. It's not a replacement for public sector funding. The projects under discussion all completed their delivery by December 2023. We are currently continuing to check and to pay out to our partners their final claims for the costs of delivering those projects. We will submit substantial reimbursement claims to the European Commission in July, next month, and a final one in October this year. Those will include reimbursement claims for all structural fund projects delivered by partners and for eligible funding towards the costs of accommodation and support services for Ukrainian migrants to Scotland. The date of the final reimbursement payments from the European Commission to us will not be until 2025. As I said in my statement on the 13th of June, and as is detailed in the Scottish Parliament's Information Centre briefing, our original allocation of potential funding at the start of the programme was marginally reduced by the European Commission because some of our partners did not meet their annual spending targets. Let me be crystal clear about why. Some partners had overestimated the amount and pace at which they would incur costs. Others were unable to meet the very strict criteria for projects, and some partners struggled to prove eligibility for all their costs. For all these reasons, it did mean that some potential funding was foregone, as an European Commission official pointed out as a statement of fact back in 2019. Changes to funding allocations have happened in other parts of the UK and indeed across Europe over the past 40 years of the programmes. However, no money was handed back. It is simply that the ceiling of total funding allocations to Scotland was lowered. It did not impact on the delivery of any projects underway or the ability of any partners to extend projects or to claim funding back from the Scottish Government. Those are important points because the contrary has been claimed publicly. As I said previously, Scottish Government officials repeatedly encourage our partners and via COSLA to spend their allocations, to put forward any new projects or to expand existing ones to maximise the use of the funds. But as I explained before, many projects and types of spending are simply not eligible. European structural funds cannot be used for anything which could or should be met from regular domestic budgets. It must be additional. Presiding Officer, in previous years, Scotland was involved in each of the funding cycles, which meant that projects that didn't secure funding in one cycle, perhaps because of timescale constraints, could always consider the subsequent cycle. The difference here is that this is the last cycle. There is a definitive endpoint entirely because we are no longer in the European Union and not benefiting from the current cycle that means funding is being distributed. That isn't a decision that the Scottish people supported by a majority. In fact, it's entirely because the current UK government removed Scotland from the European Union and, by extension, removed them from eligibility for the next cycle. So whilst all parties are entitled to scrutinise the decisions taken by the government, and I look forward to answering questions, there is a great irony in the fact that this has only become of interest because Scottish projects will not benefit from any future funding cycles of European structural funds, a decision formally supported by the Labour Party and the Conservative Party, who have both stated publicly that they do not support a return to the European Union for Scotland. A full and up-to-date list of Scotland's European Structural Fund projects and our partners who delivered them is available on the Scottish Government website. Members can see the huge range of projects and programmes that have been supported through European funding. Many local authorities, such as Perth and Kinross's Positive Future projects, have provided debt management, fuel poverty, housing and education advice programmes in their areas, part funded by the European Social Fund. The supporting New Scots and Stirling project provided a holistic service that includes money management, benefit advice, social inclusion activities and English for speakers of other language courses to the growing number of refugees settling in the Stirling Council area. That ESF-supported project offered eligible participants access to specialist money support and training, often from the very first day of their arrival in Stirling. On a bigger scale, employability pipeline projects delivered by councils across Scotland supported people with multiple barriers to assist them to get a better chance of securing employment. The Youth Employment Initiative in the west of Scotland helped young people aged 16 to 24 years old access the labour market. That support also came through the European Social Fund. On the European Regional Development Fund side, the Medical Device Manufacturing Centre has been supported to the tune of £1.6 million. The MDMC project is made up of a team of engineers, scientists, clinicians from across four universities who provide medical service developers with advice, access to manufacturing facilities, engineering and technical expertise, and regulatory advice for companies seeking to translate device concepts into commercial products. They have a comprehensive suite of manufacturing equipment installed in dedicated labs at Heriot-Watt University, ranging from laser-based manufacturing equipment to medical device packaging and environmental testing equipment. ERDF funding also contributed £10.6 million towards connecting communities across the Highlands and Islands. The Scottish Government's £21 million 4G infill programme is improving Scotland's rural mobile phone coverage in selected hotspots, areas where no commercial coverage has been rolled out. And without intervention, those rural areas would miss out on improved connectivity and the benefits that that would bring to home, working life and the wider local economy. Thanks to ERDF support, police, ambulance and mountain rescue emergency services can provide rapid response to local and national crises, offering better resilience as a result of improved communication between people in the control rooms and those out in the field. For the local community, improved 4G coverage potentially makes the area more attractive to tourists and offers social benefits, such as improved access to services and keeping in touch during COVID-19. It certainly makes my life a lot easier when working as I travel across the Highlands and Islands. All those projects are testament to the immense benefits that European funding has delivered over the years. They reflect just a snapshot of the benefits that European structural funds have brought to Scotland's businesses and communities. Those projects are all from the current programming period, which will sadly be our last, as we enter the lengthy process to formally bring them to a close. As I said just less than a fortnight ago, every pound or euro that can be claimed back will be claimed back. And I will report on that when the final position is confirmed. And hopefully, Presiding Officer, that won't be in another 2 weeks. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. The Deputy First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which time we will move on to the next item of business. I would ask those members who would wish to ask a question to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call Liz Smith.
Thank you. Can I thank the Deputy First Minister for prior sight? Deputy Presiding Officer, I made this request for a second statement because of the total lack of clarity on the part of the Scottish Government to explain the facts about what has happened to large sums of EU taxpayers' money. And today's statement still leaves questions unanswered. So can I seek complete clarity on the following? Firstly, in the minutes of a meeting on the 14th of November 2019, chaired by the Scottish Government and attended by representatives of lead partners and EU Commission officials, the Scottish Government advised the meeting as follows, and I quote, "The managing authority, that's the Scottish Government, is unable to pay claims until the suspension is lifted." And that was backed up in the statement in the Scottish Government consolidated accounts for 2018-19. But just a few days ago, in a comment to The Times, the Scottish Government has said, and again I quote, "In practice, no payments were affected." Deputy First Minister, that cannot be correct. And I ask you to comment on that. Secondly, for complete clarity, once and for all, exactly how much EU money has been left on the table and unspent because the relevant deadlines for claims have passed? And thirdly, just how many times did the structures for distributing the funds in Scotland between the Scottish Government and local authorities change between 2014 and December 2023 in order to address audit failings?
Deputy First Minister.
Thanks. And I actually do thank the member for quite clear questions, which I'll go through one by one, because they are actually quite simple to answer. So on the first one, in relation to the minutes that she quotes, I can say directly to her that at no point did the Scottish Government pause the payment to our partners of the funding that they had incurred. So she is right to quote directly from the minutes, but I can say unequivocally that the Scottish Government paid out the funding at our own risk. We recognised the funds that had been, the costs that had been incurred, and the Scottish Government ensured that we paid out the funds to the partners. So there was no, as it were, lost opportunity from our partners' perspective when they incurred the costs. Secondly, she asked a very direct question about EU funding. Presiding Officer, I realise that this afternoon and the last time I did this, my answers might be a bit lengthier, but it's a complex issue and I want to be clear. In terms of EU funding, I can give these figures to her in euros. The current allocation that we have in terms of the upper ceiling is 783.4 million euros. The current amount committed to projects to date is 647 million euros. And there are two elements that will determine how much higher that figure is. The first is that we are currently going through the July deadline and then the October deadline in terms of securing reimbursement. And the second element is the funding that we will be able to reclaim for settling Ukrainian migrants. Now, I'm not in a position right now to give her that figure because the deadlines are still ahead of us. What we intend to do is to claim back every penny that we can claim. And the final deadline is late 2025. So I am delighted to return to the Chamber, Presiding Officer, in 2025 with an update on what the outturn figures are. Until that point, all I can give you is a snapshot in advance of the deadline. And in terms of the structure has remained pretty much the same over the last 40 years in terms of the reimbursement to the Scottish Government, and then the Scottish Government being responsible for reclaiming from the European Commission. Thank you, Presiding Officer, for the additional time. I hope that is clear.
I call Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by pointing out that in 2019 there was £0 handed to partners by the Scottish Government, and that was provided to me in answers to a parliamentary question that I tabled, and it was received just this week. So any further clarity in writing on that would be appreciated. I take issue with the Deputy First Minister's idea that no money, and I quote, was handed back to simply that ceiling of total funding allocations that was lowered. It is clear that this was lost opportunity, and that was expressed by EC officials, European Commission officials, to the Scottish Government in the minutes of meetings held in June 2019. The European Commission believes that there were lost opportunities. They were absolutely clear about that. The same minute, and I quote, says that the projects were hemorrhaging money from those minutes. Absolutely clear that there were significant problems. This amount of money, the initial reduction, amounts to €157.6 million of lost opportunity to Scotland. And Spice believe that the entire exposure of lost minimum loss is €294 million. So, and if I can, Presiding Officer, in questioning, there has been, you said on the 4th of June, Deputy First Minister, to the Chamber, there has been no conclusion to the scheme. It will continue and we will endeavour to spend as much as possible. But your officials are quoted on the 20th of June in the Times saying all projects supported by European structural funds were completed by December. And you've confirmed that position today. The two statements are entirely contradictory. So it's confirmed that's absolutely the case. I understand our officials must now, as a result of that December deadline, have a number. They will seek to maximise the reclaims. But what is the exposure right now of the Scottish Government for that figure that must have been set in December?
Deputy First Minister, and always
thank you. I will endeavour to answer those questions as well. Let's start with the minutes that were quoted with the engagement with European Commission officials. And that speaks to the fact that we have engaged extensively and frequently with European Commission officials. That was 5 years ago. It speaks to a constant monitoring of the situation. And also, it was the fact that we received an extension which we were encouraged to use and which we are using in order to claim back the funding. So I've already set out the deadline of July and October, which is an extension, and we don't expect to be an outlier in any way compared with previous schemes or compared with the rest of the UK. In terms of the point he distinguishes about 2019, we absolutely did pay out to partners in 2019. And it goes to Liz Smith's question. And again, you know, I appreciate it's complex and that's not designed to be patronising, but there's two elements of this. There's the money that the Scottish Government reclaims from the European Commission, and there's the money that our partners get. So from our partners' perspective, they know that they've incurred cost. They just want the cost covered. Their costs were covered. At no point did partners not receive the costs that they needed to be covered by covered. And that was from the Scottish Government at our risk, and I've made that clear. The second element is what we reclaim from the European Commission. And it's been well documented that there was a suspension in 2019 from the European Commission to the Scottish Government. We worked with the European Commission, that was resolved. But from our partners' perspective, from a charity's perspective, from local government's perspective, there was never any pause. There was no lost opportunity in that regard. And I'm happy if there's more information that's required to deliver on that. In terms of what he perceives to be the distinction between what was said earlier and what was said today, there's no distinction. I have said very clearly that we're engaged in a reimbursement process right now. We will not know the final outturn figures until 2025. I've given the figures that we are privy to just now, but we will not know the figures until 2025. And I do not intend to mislead Parliament by giving figures that are just a snapshot in time when we know that we need to reclaim the full reimbursement and also the coverage of resettling Ukrainian migrants. Thank you once again, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We do have a number of members seeking to ask questions, so I would hope for perhaps, I appreciate the complexity, but perhaps a wee bit brevity, and I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Myrtle Fraser. Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's statement and ask how EU structural and investment expenditure funds that have already been spent and will be by the end of this financial tranche compared to resources that will be allocated by the UK Government once this resource is no longer available. And does she agree that the Tory position on this is astonishing given their complete inability to deliver levelling up funds allegedly committed years ago, including £23.7 million for my own constituency?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, it won't surprise the member to hear that there has been no comparable replacement funding from the UK Government. The closest that we have is the Shared Prosperity Fund, but if you compare EU funding with the UK Government's replacement funding, we can see that the new regime is short-term, decision-making is opaque, and we do not have the same level of autonomy as we used to enjoy when we were in the European Union. And I imagine that all of us represent communities and constituents who know the benefit of funding that came from the European Union and which are extremely exercised now to know that they cannot apply from that same EU funding and are also frustrated by the complete lack of transparency in how to apply for comparable funding like the Shared Prosperity Fund.
Murdo Fraser to be followed by Michelle Thompson. Mr. Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let's go back to the second question my colleague Liz Smith asked. Because in response to that, the Deputy First Minister quoted two figures, the sum allocated by the EU of €783.4 million and the sum committed of €647 million. That leaves a balance of €136 million not committed by the end of 23 deadline, which of course has now passed. So can any of that total of €136 million now be recovered?
Deputy First Minister.
See, with respect, I would suggest this is precisely why, when Michael Mara and others ask me to give figures, they are struggling to appreciate the distinction between giving a snapshot in time of where we stand right now and where we expect to be when the outturn figures are published in 2025. And my point is that we expect the reimbursement process to take place over the next few months. It is an ongoing discussion with the European Commission. I am not going to be able to predict precisely where we land in October because it is a two-way discussion. And layered on top of that, we have the ongoing discussions about reimbursement for Ukrainian refugees. So we are engaged in that programme. The projects that were concluded by December 2023 is what I cited in terms of my statement. But I really look forward to coming back in 2025 and being able to give final figures, Presiding Officer.
I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And there's much chest beating and claims of lost money here. Yet the position remains the same. The replacement UK Structural Fund first round granted by the UK Government was £212 million over 3 years. That is to Scotland. If we were still in the EU, Scotland would have got £549 million over 3 years. Surely this is a shortfall of £337 million lost as a result of Tory Brexit madness and handmaiden-enabled Labour Brexit madness.
Deputy First Minister.
Thank you. I've already given my comments on the Shared Prosperity Fund, which is opaque to constituents, it's centralised, it's difficult to engage with. In sharp contrast, the seven-year structural fund, and before that the cohesion programmes, enabled truly long-term valuable projects to be delivered. And I repeat a point I made in my statement, which is that previously, being part of each cycle as it developed often meant that an organisation that missed out on one cycle always knew that there was another cycle to come, which meant they weren't constrained by the timescales that we are currently constrained by. And it meant that, in one sense, money could be carried over into future cycles, not expressly like that, but that was certainly the experience of our partners. And the difference here is that there is a definitive endpoint, and we intend to claim back every penny that can be claimed.
I call Paul Sweeney, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by John Mason. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. 2 weeks ago, when I asked about the Citizens Theatre Redevelopment Project, which is a capital funding gap of between £7 and £50 million, The Cabinet Secretary told me that the Citizens Theatre project would need to meet strict criteria set out by the European Commission in order to be able to access vital funding to ensure the project does not collapse. That's despite £11.7 million of government and council capital grant funding already committed and sunk into the project. But it seems to me that the Cabinet Secretary is now suggesting that the remaining European structural funds are not available to the overrunning Citizens Theatre project, despite it being the sort of cultural heritage project that would typically be funded via European structural funds. Is it not simply the case that this is now an example of government mismanagement that has squandered available funding that could have been used to reinforce this critical project in Glasgow?
Deputy First Minister.
The point I made in my previous answer was that the criteria that is set by the European Commission is extremely strict. It's quite rigid, and it's one of the reasons why not many organisations are eligible for claiming back that funding, and that's been the feedback from some of our partners as well. I've said in my statement, and I should just add, you know, we are very keen to engage with Paul Sweeney on the substantive issue of the Citizens Theatre and to ensure that we support that project to be as successful as possible, and I know conversations are ongoing with the relevant minister in that regard.
I call John Mason to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. I mean, to follow on from Michelle Thompson's question, the Cabinet Secretary, Deputy First Minister, said in her statement, in previous years Scotland was involved in each of the funding cycles, which meant that projects that didn't secure funding in one cycle could always consider the subsequent cycle. So is the effect of all this that if we had still been in the EU, we could still be looking at continuing funding, but because we have been forced out of the EU, we've effectively had to jump off a moving bus, and that's why we've hit this hard deadline?
Deputy First Minister.
That's right. So when I addressed Parliament earlier this month, I stated that Scotland stands to lose access to significant funding that was theoretically replaced by EU structural funds. But the member is right to talk about the cycles. So at the end of every funding period, any leftover funding would usually count towards the next funding period. Because of Brexit, that means there is no future funds. And it means that Scotland will lose out on significant funding of euros that could be received by projects across the country.
I call Patrick Harvey to be followed by Ben McPherson.
I share the frustration at those members who are happy that we're out of the European Union but pretending to be sad that we've lost European funding. However, I'm still unclear about some of the DFM's answers in response to media reports. Has she seen the report claiming that a paper was presented to the Scottish Government Programme Monitoring Committee in June 2019, which referred to serious deficiencies in the managing authorities, that's the Scottish Government's management and control system for the structural funds. Is that report accurate? What deficiencies were being referred to, and was anything done to correct them?
Deputy First Minister.
I have seen the report that Patrick Harvey refers to, and I've answered in brief some of the comments about the fact that the Scottish Government did take on board the points that were relayed to it by the European Commission. The important point to make is, of course, our partners didn't see a loss of funding, but in 2019, the European Commission suspended its reimbursement payments for both the ESF and the ERDF programmes due to changes and improvements that needed to be made in the management and the control of the programmes that had been identified by auditors in 2016-2017. A wholesale improvement programme was put in place to ensure absolute compliance with the regulations, and so that reimbursements restarted in 2020 and 2022 respectively. But the important part is that that did not interrupt the payment of partners' claims by the Scottish Government, and all parts of the UK and many other member states have gone through a similar scenario where they've seen their programme suspended at one time or another for those improvements to be made.
I call Ben McPherson to be followed by Brian Whistle.
Deputy Presiding Officer, it is my understanding that the allocation of the EU structural and investment funding is on a multi-annual basis, and I'm conscious that the funding period referred to in the statement has included a Brexit referendum, subsequent negotiations and a worldwide pandemic. Therefore, does the Deputy First Minister think we need to be mindful of the particular context faced during this funding period and how that impacted partners and their projects.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the member is right. As somebody who was Finance Secretary during COVID, we know precisely the impact of COVID on many of the initiatives and projects across the country, because most of the projects that are being funded by European funding are delivered by third sector organisations, local government and organisations like Nature Scot. So clearly their activities and their work were disrupted. We have sought to support them to ensure that they can maximise the claims from the European Commission. But in some cases, their entire remit changed. And as I said in my statement, they concluded that the work and the cost that they had intended to incur, they would no longer incur.
I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am going to try again to get an answer to the question posed by my colleagues and avoided by the Deputy First Minister. I will put this really simply. How much of the €136 million not committed at the end of 2023 is still eligible to be reclaimed?
Deputy First Minister.
We will try and reclaim all of it.
And I call Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The democratic will of Scotland was to remain in the EU, and Westminster have ignored this at every opportunity since. Does the Deputy First Minister agree with me that the best funding arrangement between Scotland and the EU is one where an independent Scotland is once again part of the EU, as opposed to Scotland forced to sit on the benches by Westminster?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, there is a complete irony in the questions to this statement today, because the bulk of the scrutiny and the opposition has come from two parties that believe in never again allowing Scotland to be eligible for this funding. And I think that speaks right now to the situation we find ourselves in as a country, where there is much empty opposition that completely defeats the purpose when it's about maximising the support to communities and constituents around the country. And the SNP, this government, would much rather we were benefiting right now from all of the funding rounds rather than just fixating on the ones that we can no longer claim from.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. That concludes the statement, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change positions should they so wish. Thank you.